Hey PC World fans, Adam here with the hot new PC, the Steam Deck. And yes, Gordon, it's a PC. And while it has been fun to load up some of the newest and most graphically intensive games on this thing to see how it fares under heavy load, it's not really how I intend to use it. I was mostly excited to see how well RPGs run on this hardware, which is what I've been doing for the past couple of weeks. In this video, I want to take you through 22 RPGs that I've quickly tried out to show off how well these types of games perform on the Steam Deck. This is going to be a big one, so let's dive in. Luckily, RPGs typically don't need a ton of horsepower, and it's not as important to get high frame rates, so in most cases, I think they are perfect for portable play. So what I want to do right now is run through the 22 games I have loaded and give some brief thoughts. This is by no means a comprehensive or deep dive into each title, as I've had limited time with the deck, but if you are curious to see how a certain game works right now, then hopefully this will give you a hint. You might even discover something you've never seen before and want to try it out for yourself. If that happens, let me know which game it is in the comments below, and while you're there, be sure to subscribe here on PC World for more Steam Deck videos. But I have encountered some hiccups with certain games, even if they are Steam Deck verified. On the flip side, some games that aren't verified yet have played perfectly fine. Now obviously, some of these games that have compatibility issues right now will change over time, but I still think it's worth a look right now. One last thing to note before I get started is that there are a number of games on this list that I have never played before, so all I can do is stumble through the opening bits of the game. On top of that, some of these games I've beaten on other platforms, so once again, all I have is the opening areas to show, but I will try my best to provide insight. With all that out of the way, let's get to the 22 games in alphabetical order. First up is Baldur's Gate 3, which I've never played on my own time, so I went into it fresh. It is listed as playable, but I ran into a number of problems that hindered me from poking around with it for too long. From control issues to the launcher flashing up over the gameplay, I'd be hard-pressed to take on this game with the Steam Deck in its current state. Luckily, performance was relatively stable, with native res at medium settings sticking around the smooth 30 FPS range. So I'm embarrassed to say it, but I never stuck with Disco Elysium when it was released, and was hoping that having it on the Steam Deck might get me back into it. Luckily, it is verified and plays really well. Inside the early environments, it's able to maintain a smooth 60 at native res with everything cranked up. Once outside, it can dip down into the mid-50s, but it's still not bad, and can be corrected by dropping some settings. I definitely think this is a way I'm going to finally play through it.
Small, wrinkled woman does not greet you. She nods along to something on her radio.
Now, I have put some time into Divinity Original Sin 2, thanks to it being one of the only games out there with cross-save support between the PC and the Switch. It's currently marked as playable, but running at native res with graphics on high provides an almost stable 60. But it will tax the system though, so capping it to 30 in-game helped with battery life. Even capped at 30, it was still a much better looking experience than what's available on the Switch. Apart from small text, this seems to be a great way to play it. This verified Dragon Quest title is way too long, but it's been a pretty good experience so far in the opening areas. Unfortunately, it doesn't have native 16:10 aspect ratio support, so it only displays at 720p. At that res, and with all the settings cranked, it pretty much hangs around the mid-40s. Even dropping all the available settings didn't hit near 60, but capping it at 30 and having everything cranked worked great and was a good option to save some battery. I will note that I did find turning anti-aliasing off sharpened up the image nice on the small screen and is how I would play it personally. I will also note that this game does not like to be hard closed via the Steam controls. Launching the game after that squishes everything to the center, and I had to re-download the game a couple of times in order to reset it every time I did. Moving on, Edge of Eternity has a verified tag and a nifty launch option from Steam where you can load into your latest save, a cool touch I haven't seen often. Performance in the opening areas was rough though, with frame rates hanging in the high 30s and low 40s at native res with the medium graphics preset. Capping it to 30 in-game, I was able to get a locked frame rate, which is doable with this turn-based game.
I'll be right behind you.
Okay,
come with me.
Now, I know Fallout 4 is technically a first-person shooter, but if you wanted to, you can engage in almost every encounter with turn-based gunplay, and I was curious to see how an open world like this would hang on the deck. It currently has a playable tag, and despite launcher quirks, it did actually play pretty well. At native res using the medium preset, I was hanging out in the 60 FPS range more often than not. The original version of this classic JRPG is listed as playable, and boy was it, quirks and all. Nothing to report here once I was in the game, but getting into the game proved to be a bit of a problem. With the default recommended controller layout, I wasn't able to move past one of the startup screens. Luckily, I downloaded a community layout and was able to click past it. Weird quirks indeed. Final Fantasy VIII is listed as verified, and I had no problems anywhere with this one. It played great in my short time with it. Sure, it's not a perfect remaster, but I do think it's a great fit for the deck. This 2-pack of Final Fantasy games is only marked as playable, but I had no problems getting sucked back into these, and it ran fantastic at the higher settings. Only bummer is that even if you set it to the deck's native 1280x800 resolution, it only displays a 1280x720 image, and I couldn't find a way to force it. Next on the Final Fantasy train is one of my personal favorites, which is listed as verified. This one ran better than I expected, but did have a weird quirk. At native res with graphics set to the highest setting, I was getting in the 40s and 50s depending on the area. That was with the FPS cap set to 60 in the game and VSync on. Capping the frame rate to 30 requires a restart, but once back in the game, the overlay still read 60 even though things like animations were obviously playing at 30. Turning off VSync brought the counter back down to 30 where it should be, but it actually didn't play as smooth. I'm not sure what's going on here, but having VSync enabled and capping to 30 in the game felt like the smoothest experience and what I would recommend. I knew going into this one that it would be the hardest Final Fantasy I owned for the deck to run, and boy was I right. It's listed as verified, and I didn't run into any problems, but it took some fiddling to lock in a somewhat smooth playing experience. I was able to get a fairly good experience going with the average preset, and the resolution bumped down to 75% of native res in the game. It still wasn't a locked 60, but it was close and smooth enough. It doesn't look great though, so it's kind of a bummer, and I'm not sure I'd play it this way. Also, even though it's set to the deck's native res, it still only displays at 720p. I'm starting to see a trend here. Don't wear yourself out like that. Take cover and rest up. The Last Remnant is another on my pile of shame, and I never got to it back in the day. Luckily, the opening bit showed no problems, and is indeed marked as verified. At native res and max settings, it was a smooth experience despite a couple of dips in frame rates, even during the big opening battle. For those who are wondering, Monster Hunter Rise plays great on the Steam Deck, and Stories 2 is pretty well suited for this handheld as well. It's marked as unknown, and at maxed out settings, it was hanging around the 50 FPS range in the open world sections, but locked in at 60 in battle. Unfortunately, it's yet another game that doesn't display at the deck's 16:10 aspect ratio, and actually doesn't even give the option for it, so 720p it is. This next JRPG carries a verified tag, and looks and plays fantastic on the deck, and is a nice upgrade over the Switch version. I did see some slight hitching in between loads and during some effect sequences, but nothing crazy. This was at max quality settings at native res, which doesn't fully tax the system and allows for more normal power draw. The only downside is that it's yet another game that doesn't display at 1280x800 even when it's selected. Pathfinder is listed as playable, but it does take a bit of patience to play thanks to small text and the mouse and keyboard default control scheme. Unfortunately, I didn't have my save from further in, but the opening sequence is pretty taxing on the graphics, and I think is a good example of performance. At native res, I found the medium preset to be a playable experience, but it was nowhere near a locked 60. Persona 4 is one of my favorite JRPGs of all time, and playing it a bit on the deck was a treat, even though it's listed as unsupported. From what I played, everything ran great at native res and maxed out settings, which isn't surprising given how old this title is. But I do think I figured out one of the reasons why it's marked as unsupported though, as none of the pre-rendered anime scenes played back audio. It's not a perfect way to play any game, obviously, and hopefully they address it soon. But in the meantime, Persona 4 is such a good game, I honestly wouldn't blame anyone if they found workarounds like watching the cutscenes online.
You saved me. Thanks.
Scarlet Nexus is high on my backlog of RPGs, and the deck seems to be a great way to play it. It does have a verified badge, but I did find a weird quirk. When switching the game to full screen mode, it didn't allow me to adjust the resolution above 480p. But even in borderless windowed mode, it doesn't display in the full 1280x800 resolution, and is instead 720p. Also, even with the available settings set to the lowest options, I couldn't get a locked 60 in all of the areas I explored. At the highest settings, it does stick around 60 often though, so I think it's doable, and I'm looking forward to playing it this way. I beat SMT3 on the Switch, so I don't have my save here, but what I played on the deck was fairly comparable. Like Persona 4, it's also marked with an unsupported tag, but unlike that game, I did run into a number of graphical issues while playing it. It also had some weird loading issues, and takes a long time to load in the very first time. I think you could get through it on the deck in its current state, but beware, there are some things going on here that need to be addressed. Out of all the RPGs on this list, Tales of Arise is the one I've put the most time into on the Steam Deck, clocking in at 5 hours at the time of writing this. It was already high on my backlog list, and playing it on the deck has been a blast. It's marked as verified, and other than being yet another game that only displays at 720p, I haven't run into any problems. At max settings, the game sits around the 50 FPS range, and capping it to 30 has been a great option that I've occasionally used to save on battery. This is a fantastic example of playing an RPG on the go. Torchlight 3 is marked with the unknown tag, but it actually played pretty damn well on the deck. There is one big problem that I can't seem to get around with the default controller configuration though, and that's saving any of the graphics settings. I'm able to select and change the settings, but there is no option to apply and save them in its current form. Using a mouse and keyboard configuration shows the save and apply options like usual, so there are ways to get around it, but you're going to need to fiddle with controls to do it. Once I set everything to native res and maxed out the settings, FPS was hanging around in the 40s, but bumping down the settings, I was able to get to a pretty solid 60. I've been eyeing this one for a while, and despite its current unknown tag, this seems to be the way I'm going to finally play it. Performance was a bit choppy due to some nasty frame pacing at native res and everything maxed, but it was pretty close to 60 FPS and smooth enough. The only real change I made was to raise the text size up one so it was easier to read. Last but certainly not least is Yakuza 7, which holds a verified status. I'm bummed that I started the Game Pass version of this game because it plays great on the deck. At native res and high settings, it provides a smooth 30 experience. And honestly, I'm okay with 30 in this case, and I didn't run into any problems while playing it, so I think it's a good fit for the deck. I guess I'll just have to start over if I can't snag my other save. And there you have it, 22 RPGs on the Steam Deck. Overall, I've been pleased with the experience of the deck so far, and I'm excited to dig deeper into some of these games. Thanks everyone for hanging all the way through this one with me. If you have any questions about a specific game, just drop a note in the comments. And be sure to give this video a thumbs up and subscribe to PC World for further PC hardware and software goodness. Catch you later.